In the previous part, that is the part 1 of this video series regarding the brain, I have given a brief introduction of the broad anatomical classification of the brain. In this second part of the series, I will explain the superficial visible structures of a human brain, excluding the base of the brain and the cerebellum, which are covered in the third and fifth part of this video series, respectively. Coming to the outer visible structure of the brain, you can see the outer layer of the cerebral hemispheres, composed of a highly convoluted or wrinkled outer layer of gray matter called the cerebral cortex. The crest of a single convolution is known as a gyrus, plural of which is spelled as gyri, and the fissure between the two is known as sulcus, plural of which is sulci. The longitudinal fissure partially separates the cerebral hemispheres. Each cerebral hemisphere is divided into four lobes: the frontal lobe, the parietal lobe, the temporal lobe, and the occipital lobe. The central sulcus or fissure of Rolando, which will be visible later, separates the frontal and parietal lobes. And the deeper lateral sulcus or fissure of Sylvius forms the boundary between the temporal lobe and the frontal and parietal lobes. The temporal lobe. The outer surface of the temporal lobe is an association area made up of the superior, middle, and inferior temporal gyri. Near the margin of the lateral sulcus, two transverse temporal gyri constitute the primary auditory area of the brain. The sensation of hearing is represented here in a tonotopic fashion, that is, with different frequencies represented on different parts of the area. The transverse gyri are surrounded by a less finely tuned second auditory area, a medial or inner protrusion near the ventral surface of the temporal lobe, known as the ancus, constitutes a large part of the primary olfactory area. The frontal lobe is the primary motor region of the brain. The inferior part frontal lobe, close to the lateral sulcus, as you can see, is the Broca area, a region involved with speech. The frontal cortex contains four main gyri. The inferior frontal gyrus, as you see, is made of three parts, the pars orbitalis, pars triangularis, and the pars opercularis. The pars orbitalis plays a role in the language processing network of the brain. The pars opercularis is involved in language production and phonological processing due to its connection with motor areas of the mouth, middle frontal gyrus, and the tongue. The pars triangularis is involved in semantic processing of language, the meanings of words and phrases in a particular context. The middle frontal gyrus. The middle frontal gyrus is the dominant left cerebral hemisphere. It plays a key role in the development of literacy, while the non-dominant right middle frontal gyrus is responsible for numeracy. Now we talk about the superior frontal gyrus. The dominant left superior frontal gyrus is a component of working memory and spatial processing. The non-dominant right superior frontal gyrus is involved in impulse control, modulates inhibitory control, and motor urgency. To understand dominant and non-dominant hemisphere of the brain, you can refer to part 1 of this series. The fourth frontal gyrus, that is the precentral gyrus, is directly anterior to the central sulcus, as you see here, and contains the primary motor cortex, also called Brodmann area 4. The primary motor cortex is responsible for controlling the voluntary movements of specific body parts and has sequential representation of the body parts, which is elaborately illustrated in part 3 of this video series. Injury to parts of the precentral gyrus results in paralysis on the opposite half of the body. The parietal lobe, which is predominantly sensory, is posterior to the central sulcus of Rolando. It is divided into three parts: the post-central gyrus, the inferior parietal lobule, and the superior parietal lobule. Here, you are visualizing the post-central gyrus, which is the primary somatosensory area, receiving sensory input from the opposite half of the body. The sequential representation is in the same order as in the primary motor area and is from the opposite side of the body. The inferior parietal lobule is composed of the angular and supramarginal gyri. The supramarginal gyrus is an additional portion of the parietal lobe. It is involved in perception of space and limbs location. It is also involved in identifying postures, gestures of other people. The right hemisphere supramarginal gyrus appears to play a central role in controlling empathy towards other people. When supramarginal gyrus is damaged, it causes individuals to project emotions on others, inhibiting the ability to be empathetic. This makes the individual more egocentric, mainly because they are not able to perceive the emotions of those around them. The angular gyrus, its significance in transferring visual information to Vernix area in order to make meaning out of visually perceived words. It is associated with complex language functions, that is, reading, writing, and interpretation of what is written. Vernix area is also called Vernix speech area. It is one of the two parts of the cerebral cortex that are linked to speech, the other being the Broca's area. It is involved in comprehension of written and spoken language, in contrast to Broca's area, which is involved in the production of language. Vernix area is located in the posterior section of the superior temporal gyrus, usually in the left cerebral hemisphere. The area corresponding to the Vernix area in the non-dominant cerebral hemisphere does not have much role in speech. Vernix area receives information from the auditory cortex and functions to assign word meanings. This is why damage to this area results in meaningless speech known as Vernix aphasia. The superior parietal lobule is below and behind the post-central gyrus, lies above the intraparietal sulcus. The superior parietal lobule has close links with the occipital lobe and is involved in aspects of attention and visuospatial perception, including the representation and manipulation of objects. Please note that in both the parietal and frontal lobes, each primary sensory or motor area is surrounded by a smaller secondary area. The primary sensory area receives input only from the thalamus. The secondary sensory area receives input from the thalamus and primary sensory area, or both. The occipital lobe lies behind the parietal lobe. Here, you see the primary visual area. It receives the input from the opposite visual field via the optic radiation. The visual field is represented near the calcarine sulcus in a retinotopic fashion, that is, with upper quadrants of the visual field being laid out along the inferior bank of the sulcus and lower quadrants of the visual field represented on the upper bank. Central vision is represented mostly caudally and peripheral vision is represented rostrally. In my next video, I will show the structures at the base of the brain. For the viewers who have watched only a few parts of this video series, I would advise them to watch all five parts in sequential order to understand the whole brain anatomy clearly.